Spent their Sabbath with us today. So on behalf of the Mount Zion family, we would like to welcome each one of you. I know that time is of an essence to each one of us. Some of us would like to spend time with our families outside in nature or anywhere, but you have decided to be with us today. It's a joy to see each one come to church on the Sabbath. And I would like to mention those names who have written here in our guest book. We have a few. We have Lady Nila Mauricio. If you are here, if you don't mind, can you just wave your hand? Where are you? Sister Mauricio? Lady Nila, are you maybe outside? Okay, George Sanorho from Dasmariñas, Cavite, over there. Welcome, Brother George, all the way from the Philippines. We have June and Rona Magpayo from Maryland. Okay, there you go. Welcome. And we have brothers from Filca, the Arias family. Matias, sorry. Welcome to Mount Zion. Anybody else who's there? We have a sister over there. Can you just raise your hand and your name? Don't be shy.
My name is Jay Sammy Kamato.
Ah, Kamato. Very close to Sammy Kamato. Maybe I thought you're a relative. But anyways, I'm glad that you are with us today. It is not by accident that we were able to gather here. I know God has given you the time and the calling. You know, every Sabbath, if you feel tired and just would like to rest at home, it is just good to see your family and friends come and worship God. So I give you the chance. You don't have to go around as we normally do to shake, but just look at your left side and say hi to your seatmates, and to your right and to your back, and just wave your hand and say, Happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters. We are happy to see you, and I hope to see you every Sabbath in here. Thank you. We have so many important announcements that I would like the church to know. I will go by the frequent or the first one that we are going to do. It's so sad that we have two of our dear pioneers or a very close and an inspiration to all of us who have gone ahead of us, rested peacefully. But we would like to pay tribute and time to appreciate what they have done to church by giving them a service. And tomorrow, we are invited to come over here in the church for a viewing and a service for our late Nanay Kayang Aure. It's from 3 to 7 p.m. So if you have time and available, please come. We're going to have our viewing and service here in our church. And also on Thursday, August 18, viewing for the late Mrs. Aurora Rivera at Kane Jarrett Funeral Home from 4 to 8 p.m. That is this coming Thursday. And on the 19th, which is Friday, that is the funeral service to be held here in our church at 10 a.m. So two important dates for you to pay your last respect to our very own members of this church. We have also the coming Children's Week of Prayer starting August 15 to 19. So that would be next week, from Monday to Friday, 5 o'clock in the afternoon. There will be no vacation Bible school that we normally do, but this will be a replacement of that. So support our children. Lola, Lolo, those apostolic ministry, please come over and try to support them. And Friday will be the culmination at 7 o'clock. It will be joint Vesper meeting. And they are going to, I think, have parts in there. So please remember the dates. And we have next week, which is important also, August 20 at 2:30, Ontario Conference is going to have a will planning session. What does it mean, will planning? This is an offer by the conference for those, you know, this is an important thing for us to know, that a lot of us may have no knowledge about the will. You know, you give or a written or something that is in paper, that if you say it's your turn to pass your inheritance, you have somebody to names to get it, right? Those are important because the government will take your possession or your property, your money, your houses if you don't have a will. By doing so, it is also a practice of being a good steward. In the will, this is not like an advertisement I'm giving you, but you can also plan ahead of time to give percentage of what is left of your estate or asset to the conference. And of course, it will be of good help for the mission of the church. So that is August 20 at 2:30 here. Now, I don't want to say this, but this is also sad to hear that Pastor Sheldon, our very own associate pastor, has been with us, and this will be his second to the last Sabbath. He has been with us for a few years, and I know that he's been of help, not only to pastor as side-by-side partners in ministry, but for the youth and young adults. And he will have a new calling at Niagara Falls, which is a beautiful place than us. So he like to move there. But I know we're going to be missing Pastor. This is not his last Sabbath, but I would like to announce now that next Sabbath, it will be, if there is a name in every Sabbath, there will be a farewell Sabbath. It will be his farewell here. It's not, doesn't mean that he is not allowed to come back, but this is a way of saying that we appreciate what he has done for us. So bring, we have a potluck or gathering, bring your favorite dish. Bring your favorite dish. Cook something good, special for him. And so he will not forget the food that you brought. So who knows, he might come back, right, Pastor? He will just finish his term there and come back here. Only one term, Pastor said. So next Sabbath is last Sabbath. Oh, there you go. Okay. We will talk to the conference and let him come back. I know that you're going to be missing him. I will love him so much. Pastor Sheldon, you see, they are already protesting that you should come back. But it's just a matter of what the Lord is preparing for him. I know that there's a change, but he is willing wherever, like Joshua was saying, that wherever God leads me, I will go. So that is his new assignment. And I think, Pastor, we are welcome to visit you there, just in case you move to Niagara Falls. You know, that's a good, a nice place. So anyway, that will be next Sabbath. I know that each one of us, I will use the word fear. Nowadays, fear is all over the place. Fear of the war, fear of not paying our mortgage because the rate is going up, fear of the COVID, fear of even dying. But I tell you something, fear in two meanings will define our lives. Fear means face everything and run. Fear means face everything and rise. Brothers and sisters, you have the choice whether to run or to rise. I would say and encourage each one of us, if you have fear of everything that is going on, God is above all our fears. He will lead us and he will rise and help us. And for me, I will rise again, though heavens fall. I would like to invite each one to stand as I read our call to worship. And we are inviting the Holy Spirit to be upon us as we meditate the words from the Bible, which is found in Hebrews. Give me a minute. I'm looking for it now. The title of the sermon of Pastor is Our Fundamental Belief which is regarding the high priests. And I know that God is our high priest and he will be upon us. So I read in Hebrews 10 verses 19 to 22. So now, my friends, the blood of Jesus makes us free to enter boldly into the sanctuary by the new living way which he has opened for us. We have, moreover, a great high priest set over the household of God. So let us make our approach in sincerity of heart and full assurance of faith. Let us pray. Loving Father, we cannot hide away from your presence. Though we run away and seek pleasure in this earth, you are sincere enough to find us, look for us, and redeem us back to your fold. We owe a lot to you. In reverence, we come. In faith, knowing that you are a merciful God and you will forgive our transgression. We confess everything to you today. And we lift our hearts in worship and praise, for you have been constant reminder of our failure, that you have given us an assurance of eternal life for those who are waiting and faithful upon you. In our worship, may the Holy Spirit dictate in our minds, and we ask that the double portion of your blessing be with our dear speaker, Pastor Sheldon Imperio. Grace us with your spirit and your presence. In your name I pray. Amen. Shall we all be seated?
I would like to invite all you little ones, all the young kids, to come up to the front for the children's story. And for those of you who are young at heart, if you'd like to come up too, you can come up. That's fine. Bright, shining faces this morning. Hello, my name is Auntie Astrid, and I'm going to tell you a story today, and we're going to talk about promises. Do you guys know what a promise is?
Yeah.
Yeah? Can someone tell me what a promise is?
A promise is when you say something and you have to keep it.
Yes, that's right. Thank you. Yeah, that's right. It's a pledge to do something, make something happen, or provide something. And have you guys ever made a promise before? Yes? Did you keep your promise? Maybe? Yes? I can see some maybes, yes, no's. That's all right. Maybe? Yeah. Oh, it's a secret. Okay. Yeah, so promise. Well, we'll talk about promises. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about our story in our beginner's class. One second. This is Evie, this is Eleanor. She's gonna help me tell the story. So in our beginner's class, we're learning about Elijah. Do you know Elijah, the prophet? And God made him a promise that he would meet his needs. So Elijah told King Ahab a message that there would be a drought. Do you know what a drought is?
Yeah,
can you tell me what a Melissa.
It's when there's no rain for a long time and the land's dry.
Yes, that's right. A drought. There's no rain. And you know what happens? Fruits and vegetables and plants, they need rain to grow, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, they can't grow with no rain. So what happens to the fruits and vegetables when there's a drought?
They die.
That's right. They wither and they die, and it's hard to find food and water. That's right. So what did God do to help Elijah when he was hungry?
He turned the stone into bread.
Oh, that was close. So he used his special friends, ravens, to bring him...
meat.
Meat and bread. That's right. Isn't that cool? God used ravens to feed Elijah and meet his needs. Does anyone have a pet? Do you guys have a pet? You have a pet? What kind of pet do you have? You have a fish? Do you think your fish would bring you bread and meat if you were hungry? No? It's too small. How about you?
Sometimes me and Lex just keep ants.
Ants? Do you think they'll bring you food when you're hungry?
No, not much.
But they can for themselves. They
yeah, for themselves. Yes. So maybe if God asks them to, they could bring you food. But we're going to talk about promises. So our promises, some of you said that... sometimes you didn't keep your promise. So I'm going to show you this. What is this? Just a piece of paper. This is like our promises. Does it look very strong? No, it looks kind of flimsy. Can I get some helpers? Yeah, you can come up. Here, can you hold that piece of paper? You can come too. Okay, I have a few pieces of paper. Can you get that? Okay, we'll have... Okay, so these are like our promises, our human promises. We may not always mean it, but they're not very strong all the time. Now, can you guys break or rip the paper?
Okay, rip it.
Yeah, rip it. Rip it, yeah. Was that easy to do or was that hard?
Pretty easy.
Pretty easy? How about you? Was that easy or hard?
Easy.
Easy. Yeah, so our promises are like these papers, and they're easily broken. Was that easy?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, you guys are pretty strong, right? God's promises are found here. We're not going to rip this, but they're found here in the Bible. And so God has many promises in the Bible. Thank you. Okay, if you can put the papers back in here, I have another one that you guys can try. So God's promises, do you know how many promises are in the Bible? Can you guess? How many? Do you know how many are in the Bible? Promises?
How many?
Yes.
Yes, how many?
1, 2, 3.
Oh, 1, 2, 3. Yes, that's right. So he has many promises, up to 8,000 promises listed in the Bible. Did you know that? That's a lot. She was getting there. She was counting. So I don't have 8,000 pieces of paper, but do you think you could rip 8,000 pieces of paper?
No.
No? How about 500? This is just 500. Can you try to rip this? Can you rip it?
It's so heavy.
Is it heavy? Were you able to? Go ahead. Everyone can try. Can you? You guys can work together. Can you rip it? Oh, you got the cover off. Thank you. Woo, okay. Very good. So they were able to break the promises. So God's promises are like these papers. 8,000 promises. Okay. Yes. So which one was stronger? The one piece of paper or the 500? 100. So God's promises are like the big piece of paper. His promises can't be broken. So I have some verses here. Can someone help me read some of the promises listed in the Bible?
Okay.
have you do the first one.
This one?
Yeah, you do.
I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. John 16:33.
That's so a promise of peace and that he's overcome the world.
The Lord himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Deuteronomy 31:8.
And then, can you just read this one?
Okay. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Hebrews 4:16.
Thank you. What amazing promises from God. And we can be assured that God's promises will never break. Thank you for coming. Can we pray? Does anyone want to pray before we leave? Yeah? You want to pray, Ezra? Okay, we'll do Ezra. Yeah. Okay. We're gonna close our eyes and fold our hands. Do you help?
Jesus, thank you for this day. Please help my eaters sleep in a good day. Please help my angels to watch over us and God's give us a please that I can go to church. Amen.
Amen. Thank you all. And you can go quietly and slowly to your seats.
Good morning and happy Sabbath.
Good morning.
How blessed we are to be in God's house today. It's been 2 years when we barely seen each other. We've seen each other mostly on the internet or on Facebook, but we are so blessed to be here to sing today to our God, and how happy we are to be here today. Let's sing first song, Hallelujah, Sing to Jesus.
Trial is the victory.
inviting everyone to please stand up as we sing the opening hymnal, 322, Nothing Between.
Our scripture reading for today is found on Hebrews 4, verses 14 to 16. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all the points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may be obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. May we be blessed in the reading of his word.
Now time for us to come in the garden of prayer, and I'll be reading the names of the family that we will be praying for today. We'll be praying for the family of Malangyaon, Lauren Cecilia. Please come in front if your name is called. Cecilia, Esther, and Irene, Malangyaon, Jaime Fe, Jamie and Jasmine, Maliare, Rolando, Elizabeth, Ruel and Sarah, Manalo, Romulo, Marcelina, and Titus, Manalo, Michael, Lizelle, Jacob and Jasmine, Manansala, Kenneth, Rowena, and Emery Keith, Mariano, Efren, and Gloria, Narciso Bughao, Estella Balikat, Joshua Oliver Castro, and Liz Aquino. And for those who have special prayer, please come in front. Let us pray. O dear kind Heavenly Father, our Creator God, we thank you, Lord, that you are faithful to fulfill all your promises. You have said that you dwell in the hearts of your people through the presence of your Holy Spirit. When your church gathers together, we are in the midst of us. You are in the midst of us. Hear our prayer and strengthen your church, Lord. You are a God of peace. May you sanctify us completely. And may our whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. You are who called us, are faithful to the end. Lord, use your church to provide a heaven of safety and refuge for those in need. Use your church to extend your kingdom in the world. Use your church to bless the communities in which they are placed. Use your church to refresh and revive the weary and hunting. Use your church to equip your people for works of love and service. Use your church to proclaim the joyous message of God, of the gospel. Use your church to demonstrate your faithfulness, Lord, to a watching world. And Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the light of the world, for guiding our steps on your path. Your word says that you are the God Father who gives us good gifts, and we thank you, Lord, for all the gifts that we received from thee. And we thank you, dear Lord, for the gift of our church. And thank you, Lord, for our pastors, We pray, Lord, that you bless them and keep them in your holy hands. May you guide them, Lord, to proclaim your soon coming to this world. Give us strength to live as ambassador for you in the world, Lord. And bless your church also, Lord, and keep us pure. Make your face shine upon us and through all our community and to the people we live day by day and those other people we come along. May your face be seen in us. Lord, we pray for our families, those families that I have mentioned. A house cannot function if its members are not the same page. How can we all walk together, lest we agree? Therefore, it is a good help to us to come together for the goal of unity, Lord. Give us all love and compassion for one another so that this family might serve as a great example for others. Let our spiritual life flourish, that our bonds may grow tighter in you, Lord. And Lord, please give us good health. You are a great physician, Lord. Heal our bodies and all of those people who are sick, families, all the diseases that we have right now, Lord, please touch our body and heal us. Help us so that we can focus even more on you rather than ourselves. And Lord, you are a great provider. Thank you so much, Lord, for you have given us everything in this world, in this, that we may enjoy all the wonders that you have created. Especially, Lord, today, we thank you for your Sabbath, that we can find rest in our day-to-day lives. God in heaven, fill the hearts of those that are sick, dying, and elderly with hope. Remind them that nothing is too difficult for you, because all power and mighty are in your hands. Father, we ask that you restore them and make them healthy again, that they may be able to serve you and glorify your name. Lord, maybe they soar on wings like eagles, that they may run and not grow weary, they may walk and not faint. And also, Lord, we pray for the peace and comfort for the family of Auris and the Rivera. Lord, we know how difficult it is to lose a loved one. We pray for their family, Lord. Give them peace. Give them comfort. We are here as a family in this church, and we will support them, Lord. Give us all the means to comfort the family. And at this moment, Lord, I will give the time for these families who are here, Lord, in your presence, to pray for their special request. Thank you, dear Lord, for saving us from all the sins we have committed against thee. And thank you, Lord, for everything, for you love us so much. And thank you, Lord, that you are a God. You are a Father in heaven. And we are we are excited for you to come back and bring us home into that heavenly kingdom. For all these things we ask, in the loving name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
It is now time for us to worship the Lord through giving our tithes and offering. And today the offering will go to the Christian Record Services. Today is assigned this Sabbath in North American Division, the U.S. and Canada, to give our offering for the Christian Record Services for the blind. A day to come together and support this vital work. Church members will learn about our ministry, the work that God is doing in the lives of people who are blind or experiencing vision loss, and the effective ways we are sharing the gospel in partnership with friends like you. Isn't that exciting? What a wonderful opportunity to come together as believers working as one, so children, teens, and adults can learn more about Jesus through the programs like Phone Faith, National Camps for Blind Children, and through Bibles and resources in Braille, large print, and audio formats. Even more important, with the support from compassionate friends like you, we'll keep sharing the love, comfort, and hope of Jesus. For those who have been faithful in giving, you can still continue to do so by observing the mediums that are in our screen. And we have also a basket here that we can give our envelopes as we go. Shall we pray? Loving Father in heaven, we're so glad that it is not only those who can see that you have put emphasis and important emphasis in your sight, yet we have also the blind, those who are impaired and have partial loss of their vision that can be ministered and can benefit of this ministry. I ask that you will touch every children of yours to share the burden of spreading the gospel to those who are in need, particularly for the record services for the blind. Please prosper each one of us. May our hands work diligently to earn for our livings, so the blessings that you have given us will be shared to those who are in need. Bless each family, bless our profession, bless our work. We give you the honor, for you have blessed us so much. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Do you know that following God's instructions about economy and savings is also a way to provide us with means to worship Him? In several instances, God has taught his children the practice of savings. He inspired Joseph, the son of Jacob, to advise Pharaoh not to eat everything during the 7 years of abundance, but to keep 20% for later. On the night the Israelites had to celebrate the first Passover, before leaving Egypt, God's first instruction was for them to choose the right size of lamb according to the number of people in each family. At the end of the multiplication of bread and fish, the clear directions were for the disciples to gather the pieces that were left over. He insisted on telling them, "Let nothing be wasted." This same message about being penny wise is pertinent for today. We are preparing and eating more than what we need daily, buying more than what we need to wear, and buying houses with far more space than we need to live. This consumption-oriented society influences us to adopt a lifestyle where we constantly get more than we need. In other words, the mindset is often like this: if I can pay for it with available or borrowed money, there is no problem with purchasing it. This can be socially acceptable, but is this good stewardship? Saving will help us prepare for life emergencies, realize major financial goals, prepare for retirement, leave a financial legacy, and enjoy other benefits. Furthermore, we will be better positioned to partner in God's mission. Jesus and his missionary crew were supported by a group of women who used their own means. Ellen G. White challenges us to channel our resources properly. Each should keep a missionary box at hand and drop into it every penny he is tempted to waste in self-indulgence. Is this not time to identify and fix the leakages in our financial lives? Today, we have another opportunity to use our savings to worship God through our tithe and promise, regular and systematic offerings. May we put our desires last and God first.
Hello. Making all a list of all of the good things you've done for Lord, I've never been one to complain, but right now I'm lost and I can't find my way. My world's come apart and it's breaking my heart, but it helps to know that your heart is breaking too. When I cry, when I hurt, you hurt. When I've lost someone, it takes a piece of you too. When I fall on my face, you fill me with grace. 'Cause nothing breaks your heart, it tears you.
Takes a piece of you too. When I fall on my face,
You're the one who calmed the raging sea. You're the one who made the blind to see. You look through all of heaven and eternity. And through it all you saw me. When I cry, you cry. When I hurt, you hurt. When I've lost someone, it takes a piece of you too. When I fall on my face, you fill me with grace. 'Cause nothing breaks your heart or tears you apart like when I cry.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath to all of you. Hope everyone has had a good week, maybe a long or stressful week. But whatever the case, it's the Sabbath, so you can take a nice deep breath. Why don't we all do that now? Let all the stress that builds up in your neck and your back just dissipate, because it's the Sabbath. Before we go into our message today, I just want to invite everyone once again to join me in a moment of silent prayer. Let's do that now. Father God, we just bow before your awesome presence. As we open your word today, we pray that you would speak to our hearts in a very personal and powerful way. Give us a receptive heart, O Lord. If there's any pride or anything that may hinder us from hearing your voice, may it melt away in your presence. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. In our series, we come to number 24, Christ's ministry in the heavenly sanctuary. You know, as Adventists, we put a lot of emphasis on the sanctuary. And this is probably something that has largely been forgotten by many Christians around the world. You know, as Adventists, we believe that when Jesus went back to heaven, he continued his ministry in the heavenly sanctuary. And until today, he continues to minister on our behalf and intercede for his people, making available to each one of us the benefits of his atoning sacrifice. And then we also believe that in 1844, he began a second phase of his ministry. He's still doing the first things that he did in his first phase, but he began another phase, which we otherwise known as the investigative judgment. And we are, as we speak, living in that final period of judgment just before Jesus will come. I won't be unpacking in detail, you know, the 2300-day prophecy and the investigative judgment today, but if you want to know more about that, go back to our virtual evangelism series that we did last year. and look for the sermon that I gave entitled Facing the Judgment, where I go through that time prophecy of the 2300-day prophecy and the investigative judgment. But today I want to look at the sanctuary and give kind of like an overview of what it was about, some of the things that they did, the different sacrifices that they offered, the different festivals that they observed, the different furniture in the sanctuary. Because all of these little things and little details pointed to Jesus. Truly, one of the most fascinating things that we can study in the Bible is the earthly sanctuary as it points to the heavenly sanctuary. For those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, what is the sanctuary? In the Old Testament, Moses was commanded to put up this tent. In Exodus 25, verses 8 to 9 says, "Let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell in their midst, exactly as I show you concerning the pattern of the tabernacle and of all its furniture, so you shall make it." God commanded Moses to make this sanctuary, this tabernacle. It looked like this large white tent, so that God may dwell in their midst. Now, what's important to notice in this verse that I just read is that God gave Moses a pattern. Maybe we could say a blueprint by which to design the sanctuary. And that pattern was based off the heavenly sanctuary. So there's a real sanctuary in heaven, and the earthly sanctuary that Moses built or constructed or designed was to be a reflection of the heavenly sanctuary. The earthly sanctuary wasn't the real sanctuary. It was more so a reflection or an illustration of the real sanctuary in heaven. If I can give an example, you know, I think about this game I used to play when I was younger. It's called Microsoft Flight Simulator. I don't know if anyone has ever played that game. Basically, it is exactly what it's called, a flight simulator, where it mimics, you know, different planes, and you can learn how to operate an aircraft. You could literally learn how to fly a plane through this simulator. And it has all the different toggles. You know, that picture almost looks real, right? But it's actually the simulator. And through that, you learn how to take off, you learn how to land, you learn how to go into autopilot and control all of those things. I can't remember how to do it, but if I still remember it, I could probably fly a plane, you know, maybe roughly so. You wouldn't want to be a passenger, but I could probably operate a plane if I remembered how to do the simulator. The earthly sanctuary was like a simulator. It simulated the real thing that was happening in the heavenly sanctuary. You know, all of the sacrifices that took place in the earthly sanctuary pointed to the actual in heaven, which pointed ultimately to Jesus Christ. The reason why it's so important to study the earthly sanctuary is because it will give us a glimpse of what God is doing in the heavenly sanctuary. Now, the question is, what is the whole point of the sanctuary? What was its purpose? Why is there a sanctuary to begin with? I believe one of the primary purposes of the sanctuary is it is the solution to sin. The sanctuary shows us God's grand plan of salvation. It shows us everything that Jesus has done throughout history at the cross and onward. When you study the earthly sanctuary, you'll have a better, deeper, richer understanding of what Jesus did for us and how he saves us. It will give us a more complete understanding of his plan of salvation for you and me. So today, I just want to give you a little teaser of some of the different aspects of the sanctuary, the earthly sanctuary, as it reflects the heavenly sanctuary. I don't have the time to, you know, go through all the details exhaustively because, you know, it would take probably an entire month series to really study in detail the earthly sanctuary. But I want to go through a few things, like some of the furniture, the sacrifices, etc. Now, one thing that's interesting in the Old Testament is that there was another sanctuary built not by Moses, but by Solomon. They call it Solomon's Temple, which was bigger and grander than Moses' tabernacle. But what's interesting is that Solomon's Temple was also patterned after the blueprints that God had given to Solomon, or to David. It says here in 1 Chronicles 28, "All this he made clear to me in writing from the hand of the Lord, all the work to be done according to the plan." In other words, God himself gave the plan to David and to Solomon to build the temple. But why is it that Solomon's temple looked quite different from Moses' sanctuary or tabernacle, even though they both received the plans from God? It's because in the end, it's not so much about the physical dimensions. The earthly sanctuary does not completely or 100% reflect the heavenly sanctuary. But what's important is the meaning and the symbolism behind the different things that took place in the earthly sanctuary. But in reality, the heavenly sanctuary is much more glorious and more grand. But what's important is that we understand the symbolism, we understand the types, as it points to the anti-type, as they call it. Now let's look at a few pieces of the furniture in the earthly sanctuary. One of the first things in the outer courtyard, before you even enter into the sanctuary, is what they call the laver, or it's like a wash basin. There was water inside. And basically this laver was, you know, this container that had water, and before the priests did any of the sacrifices, before they went into the sanctuary, they had to wash themselves. And you might wonder, what's the purpose of that? Is it just hygienic reasons? I believe there's an important spiritual lesson with the laver. Before you handle any holy, you know, equipment, before you handle any holy things, you need to come with a pure heart, with a clean conscience. And the same is true for us today. When we come to God in prayer, when we read the Bible, when we come to God here in worship, when we engage in ministry, when we surrender our lives to Christ, when we place our faith in Him and His sacrifice, we need to handle it with a heart of consecration, with a spirit of purity. Our lives, our minds, our hearts needs to be cleansed by the water of the Holy Spirit. Many times when we come to church and worship, we handle it in such a haphazard, casual manner, not realizing that we are standing on holy ground. And so the lesson of the laver tells us that when we approach God with sincerity and with consecration. The next piece of furniture we find is the altar, also in the outer courtyard. The altar was where they made all the sacrifices, where all the animals were sacrificed, whether it was the burnt offering or the sin offering, etc. Now, what's interesting about the altar that I want us to notice is this. What does the altar actually represent? Is there an altar in the heavenly sanctuary? Do we find an altar in the heavenly sanctuary? I would submit to you that the actual altar was here on earth. The altar of the earthly sanctuary pointed to the cross where Jesus died. That was the actual altar. Because when Jesus died on the cross, he was the ultimate and final sacrifice. The altar pointed to the Roman cross where Jesus died just before he went back to heaven and went to the holy place of the sanctuary. When we go into the sanctuary, we have the table of showbread. There was 12 pieces of bread on this table, and it was also called the bread of presence. It was to be there 24/7. There was always to be bread on the table, and it was replaced on every Sabbath. And they made sure that when they got rid of the old bread, the new bread immediately replaced the old bread. What does the bread on the table represent? It was to be a constant thank offering, or like a grain offering, in which the Israelites acknowledged God as the source of their life and their blessings. They recognized that if it weren't for God, they would not have bread to eat. If it weren't for God, they wouldn't be alive. It was their way of acknowledging everything we have, the bread that we eat, our livelihood, everything that we have is from God. And the same is true with us today. We may not have this today, but every day we acknowledge that the breath in our lungs, the money in our bank account, the clothes that we wear, the car that we drive, the house that we sleep in, everything that we have today is from God. And it pointed to Jesus as the bread of life. It's because of Jesus that we live and breathe and move. It's because of his sacrifice. It's because of his sustaining grace that you and I still breathe and are alive today. You know, as Christians, we need to live in such a way that we recognize that we're here because of Christ. Sometimes we think, oh, I'm here because I work hard, because, you know, I'm the one that earns my money. I'm the one that has a job. I'm the one that owns these things. No, as Christians, we recognize everything we have is a blessing from God. That's the lesson we get from the table of showbread. And there's so much more, but I don't have the time. The next one is the lampstand, or what we could call the candlestick. We learn from the book of Revelation that the lampstand represents the church. The church that is to be a light to the world, constantly burning. What was interesting about the lampstand was it had to burn 24/7. It was to be lit 24/7. They had to constantly supply the lampstand with oil. And of course, the oil represents the Holy Spirit, right? They were never to allow that lampstand to burn out. So even today, the church needs to constantly be the light of the world. We constantly need a fresh supply of the Holy Spirit. And what's amazing is God promises us that the Holy Spirit will always be available in abundant supply, again, through Jesus Christ. Because Jesus died on the cross, we have an unlimited supply of oil. The question is, are you making use of that oil? The oil is there, but are you filling your lamp with oil? Is Mount Zion filling its lamp with oil? The oil is promised, but it's up to us to continually receive the oil of the Holy Spirit. The next piece of furniture we talk about is the altar of incense, where there was incense burning on the altar. And we learn again through Revelation that the incense represents the righteousness of Christ. And that when we pray to God, our prayers are mingled and covered by Christ's righteousness. You know, as sinners, we have no business coming to God's presence. We are completely unworthy to come before God's throne, even if you think you're a righteous person. All of us are sinners. We're completely unworthy to pray to God. But when you pray, as weak and as flawed as you are, your prayers are covered with the righteousness of Christ. So that when your prayers reach the throne of God, they come spotless and perfect and acceptable to God. Always remember, every moment that you pray, when you get down on your knees and you pray, your prayers are covered in the righteousness of Christ. When you approach God's throne, you're covered in the righteousness of Christ. And that's why we can come before God's presence. I want to talk also about the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant was perhaps one of the most important pieces in the what we call the most holy place. This was where God dwelled. His presence was above the ark. And inside the ark was the Ten Commandments, showing that God's law, which is a transcript of his character, is foundational to his government. But what's so interesting about, imagine that this is the ark. inside is the Ten Commandments, and then covering the Ten Commandments was what they called the mercy seat. It's not a chair, it's a covering. They call it the mercy seat. And once a year, during the Day of Atonement, the high priest would sprinkle the blood of the sacrifice before the mercy seat, representing that the blood of Christ, you know, covers us and cleanses us, despite the fact that we have broken God's law and are worthy of death. The blood of Christ covers us and cleanses us. And so here in the sanctuary, you have a combination of God's justice and God's mercy in perfect harmony. There's God's justice and there's God's mercy. Even though we have broken the law, we are covered with the blood of Jesus. If you place your faith, of course, in the cross. When you look at the sanctuary, you recognize that God is an awesome God that needs to be feared and worshipped. But he's also a God of love and mercy, who forgives us, redeems us, and cleanses us. There were many different sacrifices that they did. Let me go through a few of them. One of the first sacrifices is the burnt offering. They call it the burnt offering because it was completely consumed. It was completely burned up on the altar. And one of the things that tells us is that Christ's life was completely consumed, completely poured out for you and me. The Bible tells us that God gave everything so that you and I could be redeemed. When Jesus came, you know, left heaven, came to earth, and died on the cross, he spent his life completely so that you and I could have a chance of being saved. There was nothing that God spared. There was nothing that God, that Jesus, you know, did not do so that you and I could be saved. There was no expense that he left on the table so that you and I could be saved, even to the point of giving his final breath. The burnt offering also tells us or calls us to completely and fully consecrate our lives to Jesus. It's kind of like when Paul says that we present our lives to God as a living sacrifice, completely consecrated to God. What was interesting about the burnt offering, there was what they called the regular daily burnt offerings, twice a day. In the morning and in the evening, they would offer a burnt offering. Once in the morning, and that would burn throughout the entire day, and then once in the evening, it would burn through the entire night, so that there was constantly smoke ascending to heaven from the burnt offering, from morning to evening and evening to morning. And we learn a very important, you know, lesson from the regular daily burnt offering. For one, a practical lesson is, I think it tells us we need to consecrate our lives to God every morning and every evening, so that 24/7 we're consecrated to Christ. Every morning we are to once again place our faith in the sacrifice of Jesus. And every evening as well. So that from the time we wake up to the time we sleep, and from the time we sleep to the time we wake up, we're constantly connected to Christ. But the second lesson we learn here is that Christ's sacrifice is constantly available for us 24/7. Maybe after you had your morning devotions, 10 minutes later, you committed sin. And so the burnt offering, that the sacrifice of Christ is always there to cover you, to cleanse you. But you need to keep your eyes on the cross 24/7. Another offering in the Old Testament service was the grain offering. This was literally where they offered grain. You could offer grain, you can offer flour. And what does that represent? It represents, you know, when you give your grain to God, you're acknowledging that he is the source of your grain. Maybe if we had if the sanctuary was in the Philippines, we would offer rice. It would be a rice offering. It represents that God is the source of our life. You know, Jesus is what they call the bread of life. And so when you gave your grain offering, you acknowledged God as the source of your life. And we need to do that today. You know, before you eat your meal every day, you bow your heads and you pray, acknowledging that if it weren't for God, I wouldn't have this meal before me. If it weren't for Jesus' death on the cross, I wouldn't be able to be sustained by this meal and by the food that God gives me. Another important offering was what they called the sin offering. The sin offering is exactly what it sounds like. It was an offering for sin. Specifically, when you sinned against God, there was an offering that you could offer. And what was unique about this offering was they would take the blood of the offering and they would place it on what they call the horns of the altar, representing that it's that blood that covers your sin. And what's so interesting about the sacrifices, just imagine this. It's hard for us to relate because we don't offer sacrifices today, right? Who here has done an animal sacrifice? No one, right? What they had to do was you would bring your own animal. So, you know, every family, they had their own animals. They had their own livestock. Again, that's something we don't really do today. But just imagine there was a calf or an animal that you had raised from birth. But because you committed sin, you now have to offer that animal. And so you bring one of your best animals without blemish, without spot, to the sanctuary, and then you place your hand upon the animal. Why would you do that? It almost represents like a transference, like your sins were being placed onto the animal. And then you have a blade or some sort of instrument, and you yourself sacrifice the animal and kill the animal. And it's hard for me to fathom doing that to my own livestock. And then they take the blood of the sacrifice and they put it on the horns of the altar. But I just want you to imagine, if you are one of the Israelites in the Old Testament, when you committed sin against God, and it comes to your mind, you need to kill an animal with your own hands. What does this, what lesson was God trying to teach his people? When you commit sin, it's like you crucify Jesus again on the cross. And sometimes we take sin so lightly. You know, we commit sin like it's nothing, like it doesn't matter, and it doesn't even bother our conscience. But if you had to slaughter your own animal with your own hands, that would really burn in your memory the effects of sin. That the consequence of sin is death. And that every time you commit sin, it's like you crucify Christ afresh on the cross. Who was it that nailed Jesus to the cross? Was it the Romans? It was you and me. It was you and me. Another offering was the guilt offering. There's, you know, different meanings behind the guilt offering, but one of them was that when you sinned against your fellow man, you offered a guilt offering. And not only did you offer the offering, you had to restore to the person that you sinned against. So, for example, if you stole something from your neighbor, you had to restore back to that person what you stole plus 20%. That was the guideline of the offering. And so when you sin against God or you sin against man, you restore it to God or you restore it to man, and you give 20%. And there's an important lesson here. When you sin against someone, as a part of true repentance, you try to make right what you did wrong, which might mean, you know, approaching that person and apologizing to them. It might mean doing something to undo what you did to them, whatever the case may be. You remember the story of Zacharias. What did he say to Jesus? Whatever I have stolen from others, I will restore to them. Was it fourfold? I can't remember now. But the point is, when you repent genuinely and sincerely through Christ, you also make an effort to undo or to make right what you did wrong. And the last one I want to talk about is the well-being offering, or some translations call it the peace offering. This is probably one of my favorite offerings. What was interesting about the well-being offering was the person who offered the offering or the sacrifice also partook of it. They ate of their sacrifice, and also the priest partook of the sacrifice, almost like they had some sort of fellowship meal. It was as if God was partaking of the sacrifice as well as you. One of the first things that it points to is that when you place your faith in Christ, you partake of Christ and his flesh, almost as if you are assimilating Christ's life to you. You see, when you place your faith in Christ, not only does he forgive your sin, but you also obtain Christ's character. You assimilate his character and his life upon yourself. But the second thing it points to is that you enter into this fellowship with God. And that's why you have that almost like that fellowship meal. Do you remember the story of Solomon when they dedicated the temple? They had like thousands of animal sacrifices. You might think, oh, that's a big waste of meat, you know, all those animals. But that was basically a bunch of peace offerings or well-being offerings. And they had this grand feast together. What is God trying to teach us through this peace offering or the well-being offering? I believe what he's teaching us is that when we place our faith in Christ, we enter into an intimate, special fellowship with God, a special relationship with him, and it brings us peace and well-being. When you place your faith in Christ, the result is peace. The result is well-being. You see, being a Christian is not just about believing that Christ died for your sins. It's also about entering into an intimate relationship with him. And what I want you to notice is there's many offerings, but they all point to Jesus. And what's so important to realize here is that the earthly sanctuary gives us a fuller understanding of the life of Christ and his sacrifice for us. You know, sometimes we think, okay, Jesus, he died on the cross and he died for my sins. That's it. But when you study all of these different sacrifices, we realize there's so much more to the cross than we realize. And so I've only scratched the surface. I want to invite each one of you to study deeper into the earthly sanctuary and its services. The last things that I want to go through is the different festivals, the feasts that they had in the Old Testament connected with the sanctuary. One of the first important ones is the Passover. The Passover, of course, you know, connects back to Exodus when they were leaving Exodus, and they had to offer a Passover lamb, take the blood of the lamb and put it on their doorposts so that when the destroyer came, they would be spared, right? And I won't go into so much detail on that. But that pointed to who? To the Passover lamb, Jesus Christ, who is the true Passover. And because of his blood, our lives are spared from the destroyer of death. What did the Passover point to? It pointed to the crucifixion of Jesus. And I forgot to mention that all of these different festivals you can find in Leviticus chapter 23. When you look at Leviticus 23, the entire chapter covers all of these different festivals. The next one is the offering of the first fruits, which happened right after the Passover on Sunday, or on the first day of the week, I should say. And so the Passover lamb was sacrificed on Friday, you know, well, that's when Jesus was sacrificed, and it happened to land right on the Passover when the Jews were observing the Passover. So Jesus was crucified on Friday, and then they observed the first fruits on Sunday, or on the first day of the week. And what does the first fruits point to? Or the offering of the wave sheaf, they call it. It pointed to the resurrection of Christ. Again, they all point to Jesus. And then after the first fruits, they had what they called the Festival of Weeks. Counting from the first fruits, they counted 50 days. 50 days, or what we call Pentecost. And what does that point to? It points to Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit was poured out, signifying that, you know, Jesus was enthroned in heaven and his sacrifice was fully accepted. And so the Holy Spirit could be sent out at Pentecost. And then we have the Festival of the Trumpets, which which announced to the people that the Day of Atonement was approaching. You know, speaking of the Day of Atonement, which we believe as Adventists began in 1844, what took place before the Day of Atonement? There was this grand revival that swept, you know, especially in the United States, where people were expecting the advent of this, you know, the second coming of Jesus Christ. And God prepared people for what was about to happen in 1844. And after the Day of Atonement, shortly after, they have what they call the Festival of Booths, which basically was where they would, you know, dwell in tents to commemorate or remember when they would dwell in tents in the wilderness. And so let me go through all of these, you know, once more. The Passover points us to the crucifixion of Jesus. Right after the Passover, you have the first fruits or the wave sheaf offering, which points to the resurrection of Christ and the first fruits, the initial early resurrection where other people were resurrected alongside of Christ. And then you have the Festival of Weeks leading up to Pentecost, signifying Jesus' enthronement in heaven when the Holy Spirit could be sent to the earth and poured out upon the people. And then you have the Festival of Trumpets, which I believe points to the revival that took place before 1844, which also points to the Day of Atonement, where Jesus, as we speak, since 1844, has began his investigative judgment, we call it. When Jesus finishes the investigative judgment, I believe when we get to heaven, we will celebrate the Festival of Booths. You see, the Israelites, they celebrated the Festival of Booths to remember when they were pilgrims in the wilderness, to remember when they were wandering 40 years in the wilderness, but now they are in the promised land. I truly believe that when Jesus comes and all of us make it to heaven, we will remember the days. We will celebrate and remember when we were here on earth in our temporary home as pilgrims going through this wilderness. I look forward to that heavenly celebration when, I don't know, maybe we'll make tents when we get to heaven and we'll dwell in tents just to commemorate what it was like, again, to dwell here on this earth. There is so much more I can say about the sanctuary that we don't have the time to go through. The point is that all these things point forward to Jesus Christ and what he is doing. And it would be of great value for us to study the earthly sanctuary so that we could have a deeper, fuller understanding of what Jesus has done for us. You know, one of my favorite books that I've read is The Cross and Its Shadow. It's a classic by Stephen Haskell. If you don't have a copy of this in your library, then you should pick it up. Basically, Stephen Haskell goes through all of the sanctuary service in greater detail, through the different sacrifices, the different furniture, the different festivals, all these things, and how it points forward to Jesus. And so if you want to study deeper the earthly sanctuary, you know, admittedly, it's a very difficult topic. When you read Leviticus and Exodus, it's a very, difficult topic to understand. But Stephen Haskell does a wonderful job to show us the richer meaning and how it connects to the cross. So go ahead and pick up this book. It's not a hard book to read. It's not a deep scholarly book. It's more of like a devotional book, but it will help you to understand the different elements of the sanctuary. What does this all point to? This points to Jesus as our high priest in heaven, ministering for you and me. What I want everyone here to remember is this, and what has been an encouragement to me is this, that all of heaven is pouring out all of its resources so that you and I can be saved. That's the point of the sanctuary, that God is doing everything he can so that you and I could be saved. When Jesus comes and we all go to heaven, none of us should be missing. If any one of us is missing, it's not because God didn't try to save us. It's because we rejected his gift of salvation. But God has spent every expense so that you and I could be saved. And so if Jesus were to come tonight, each one of us should have the assurance of salvation. Each one of us should know that because of everything that God has done for us, we can be saved. I love what it says in one of my favorite verses here, Hebrews chapter 14. It says, since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every aspect or every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. What the sanctuary teaches us is that because of God's grace and mercy, we can come before his throne in the heavenly sanctuary. Because we have a high priest who came to earth as a human being, who was tempted in every way just as we are, and yet overcame, because of this, we can come to God as well. We can approach his throne and receive the grace and the help that we need to overcome. You know, many times when we commit sin, what do? We hide from God, right? When we commit sin, we instead of coming to God, what do? We run away because we feel ashamed of our sins. But what we learn through the sanctuary and what we learn through this verse is that when you are struggling with sin, when you feel discouraged, when you feel guilty, when you feel ashamed, because we have a high priest who was tempted just as we are, that's the time we can come to God's throne and receive mercy and grace in our time of need. So if there is someone here who is struggling with sin today, if there's someone here who feels so unworthy, if there's someone here who feels that they're so guilty and unworthy to come to God, always remember, you have a high priest who is interceding on your behalf as I speak. And because of him, you can come to his throne and receive all the grace, all of the oil of the Holy Spirit, all of God's power that you need in your time of need. This reminds me of what it says in Luke chapter 22 when Jesus was speaking to Peter. He said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan demanded to have you that he may sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brothers. You know what's so remarkable about this verse? Is that Jesus himself was praying for Peter. You know, even though Peter was tempted and Satan was trying to destroy Peter, Jesus himself was praying for Peter. Jesus himself was interceding for Peter, just as he is for us in the heavenly sanctuary. So always remember this. If your friends, if your church, if your loved ones forgets to pray for you, always remember there's at least one person praying for you, and that's Jesus Christ. Jesus himself is interceding for your life in the heavenly sanctuary. So no matter what struggle you're going through, no matter what temptation you are facing, no matter what trial you are going through, Jesus is praying for you. Jesus is interceding for you as our high priest in the heavenly sanctuary. My prayer for each one of us is this, that each person here would experience the salvation of Christ. Like I said, there's none of us that should be absent when Jesus comes. There's none of us that should be lost when Jesus comes. Why? Because God has done everything he can to save you and me. The question is, will you accept his salvation? Will you place your faith in the cross today? That is my prayer.
Pray.
Praise the Lord. Jesus paid it all. Let us all rise as we sing the closing hymn, 184.
Father God, our heart is filled with joy and gratitude in knowing that you're in the business of saving people. As unworthy as we may be, we know that in Christ and in what he's doing for us in the sanctuary, we can have complete assurance that our sins are forgiven and that we are saved. Lord, help us to place our faith in you. Help us to trust not in our own works, which is like filthy rags, but let us trust in the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ. Lord, if there's someone here today who does not have the assurance of their salvation, if they do not know where they stand before you, Lord, I pray that your Spirit would touch their heart even right now as I speak. Cleanse them and wash them and enable them to walk in the newness of life. Father, we're so grateful that it's not your desire to judge and condemn us, but it's your ultimate desire to heal and to save us. And so even now, Lord, we accept your healing. At this very moment, we accept your salvation. Cleanse us now. Write our names in the book of life so that when Jesus completes his judgment, we will all be found saved and in your kingdom. We pray in his name. Amen. Amen.